بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. So now we go into the book itself. Part one, he speaks about two aspects and then there's an additional aspect he will add at the end. But the two things that he speaks about are part one on obedience. This is external obedience, external expression. Then part two is on refraining from disobedience. And that is, in that he speaks about the sins that are committed by the limbs. He deals with the eyes, the ears, the tongue. And then within the tongue, he deals with just 8 points there. And then he deals with the stomach, the private parts, the hands, the feet. And then within these were all kind of external disobediences. Then he starts to deal with internal disobediences, which are, now because this is not a very detailed book, he only deals with three things. He says envy, ostentation, conceit, arrogance, and pride. These are the three major things that underpin all of the other problems. So he'll discuss those. Then because he said in his introduction that that's what he's going to deal with, the additional part three, some Orientalists initially used to say that that is an addition to his work. It's not really from his work, somebody added it on. But according to the others, according to the majority, that is also part of his book. Because it's just so close to his style and so on as well. So the third part is about the etiquette and of companionship with the Creator and with creation. So there he'll be speaking about the etiquette with Allah, the etiquette of the scholar, the student, children and parents, how do you deal with people you don't know, and how do you deal with friends and brothers, what to look for in a friend, and the etiquette of friendship, acquaintances, and so on. So that's what he's going to deal with. So we're just going to be looking at selections from this. Now let's move on to page 24. Let's just read the beginning of this section. اعلم أن أوامر الله تعالى فرائد ونوافل. Know that the commandments of Allah Most High pertain to the obligatory and the voluntary. The obligatory acts can constitute the capital. So now he's explaining the fara'id and their relationship with the nawafil and how they impact on our life. So he's giving a metaphor. He's giving an example of business because we can relate more to that. And profit. Everybody likes profit. So he says, the obligatory acts constitute the capital by which salvation is attained. The capital, you need that. You need that seed capital to get anything. The voluntary acts are the profits by which are reached the high levels of success. So you're not going to get high levels with just a bit of capital. That bit of capital is going to establish you first. Then as you make profit, you start paying off your debts and you still have money left over because you've got more profits, then with that you'll be more adventurous. With that you'll take more risks, and you can have more power of expending your resources in different ways. So he's using that very business kind of metaphor here. The voluntary acts are the profits by which are reached the high levels of success. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah Most High says, those who draw near to me, do not draw near to me with anything better than the acts I made obligatory upon them. If you want to get close to Allah, you're going to have to fulfill the fara'id. The obligations have to be done. There's no negotiation there. Then you get somewhat close. You get within a boundary. After that, that's the most important boundary. Now you're in. You're part of the club. Then it's just getting closer and closer and higher and higher and higher. That's all done through nawafil. So that's what he says. The Prophet ﷺ said, those who draw near to me, do not draw near to me with anything better than the acts I've made obligatory upon them. And a servant continues to draw nearer to me by voluntary acts of worship until I love him. By just fulfilling the obligatory acts, you're not going to become a wali. You have to do a bit more. Then when you get to a certain level, you've done enough, you've proven yourself to Allah, then Allah will start loving you. Because you're always there showing, you have somebody, for example, who maybe doesn't even have the full qualifications, but constantly is coming and saying, can I please come, can I please come? He shows so much interest. He tries so much. But you know that they don't have the ability. Sometimes you'll just say, okay, let them in. So that is the same thing here. Now, what happens when Allah begins to love a person? And when I love him, I become the hearing with which he hears, the sight with which he sees, the tongue with which he speaks, the hand with which he strikes, and the foot with which he walks. So I said, if you want to be successful in the world, you have to be a wali of Allah. Otherwise, we will go down due to our weaknesses. If you want to be successful, be a wali of Allah, and Allah will guide you every way. I was, after i'tikaf, I was sitting talking with a few brothers, and we were speaking about a particular sheikh, a particular scholar, and what we had observed of just so perfect following of the sunnah. Now, following the sunnah is easy if you've got nothing else to do except that. But if you're so busy, where you're dealing with students, literally hundreds, calling you, speaking to you, writing to you, and just so busy managing so many religious activities of irshad, how can you then still be so particular in your wudu and everything? Because you're in a hurry. Wudu is just like a means to salat. Jaldi kar lo. But no, in everything. And it was mind-boggling. This hadith came to mind at that time, that this person is on a level of wilaya where Allah is guiding their hand, their feet, and so on, so they seldom make a mistake. So even though they're doing so much and it's humanly difficult to be so particular about these small things, they have a level of divine assistance. That's why when you hear about Maulana Ilyas, rahmatullahi alayhi, for example, or these other great scholars, Maulana Yusuf, and so many others who, even when they're on their last days, when they can't even move properly, they insist that even the person making wudu for them does khilal, saturates between the toes. You think it's a high level of obsession. Now, how can you think of these things? But that's tawfiq. That is tawfiq. You can't do it at your own will. You have to ask Allah for it. And that's the way. You just continue to get closer and closer to Allah, and then He guides you in all of these things. Once you cross a certain threshold, then you've made it. And you, dear seeker, will not be able to rise to carry out the commands of Allah Most High until you monitor your heart and limbs in every moment and every breath, from the time you wake up until the time you sleep. Every moment you're conscious as to whether you're setting your foot right or wrong. Know that Allah Most High is closely observing your innermost heart. He beholds your inner and outer being. No thought, moment, or step of yours escapes His regard, nor any of your moments of stillness or movement, both in the company of others and in the solitude of yourself. You are ever in His presence. In both the hidden and manifest dominions, nothing is still. Nothing that is still, and nothing that moves, moves, but the compeller of the heavens and earth is aware of it. That's Imam Ghazali's theological hat. This is where his theological persuasion is coming in. He's a man of many disciplines, so he could just invoke any of these disciplines and just make it an enriching discussion. That's why they say, for example, that some people are, inclined to tasawwuf from the beginning, and then they spend much of their time in that path, and they don't spend as much time studying a lot. They study enough. They're not deviant. They know what they're doing. They're helping others. But you have some other individuals who were first scholars, first academics. They first just pursued knowledge to a very high level. Then they decided to focus on this way. Imam Ghazali is one of them. Another one is Zarruq. Sheikh Zarruq from North Africa. Again, another amazing individual. And the third one, who just totally really amazes me, is Ibn Ajiba. His name is Ajib anyway, Ibn Ajiba. Again, another great scholar who has a commentary on the Burda, he has a commentary on the Hikam. Just amazing. He outdoes Bajuri in his commentary on the Burda and Ibn Hajar al-Haytami, the Qasida Burda I'm speaking about. But what you learn about these three, is that they were first scholars, then they took the way, the path. So they're enriched by all of this knowledge that they have, and they can just be way more convincing sometimes than others. So ilm, you know, ilm is very beneficial, as long as you just use it in the right way. He knows the treachery of the eyes and what is concealed in the breasts. He knows the secret and what is still more hidden. Therefore, O destitute one, cultivate a deep courtesy with the divine in your outer self as well as your inner self. The courtesy and bearing of a humble, erring slave in the presence of his supreme, all-powerful master. Recognize your position, that we are erring slaves, that we make mistakes, we stumble, we fail, we have shortcomings, and we are in front of our all-powerful supreme master. When you realize that positioning, then things become easy. When we forget that positioning and we become autonomous in our own right, that's when we start making mistakes. You will never be capable of this unless you manage your time and organize your routine of worship from morning to night. So pay attention to what is presented to you here concerning the commands that Allah Most High has laid upon you from the time you awake from your sleep until the time you return to your bed. And that's how he starts his book, and he discusses how you wake up and how you do all of these things. So we're not going to go through this section. You can inshallah read it yourself. But I'm going to just discuss a few different sections. So in this one, he says, when you awake from your sleep, try to awake before dawn and let the first words in your heart and on your tongue be the remembrance of Allah Most High. Our first activity when we wake up is, we have an alarm on our phone, so we've just put it off. We get it, rub our eyes, and just check, are there any text messages, are there any messages, any tweets or whatever? Okay. That's the way we wake up. That's the difficulty of Facebook and Twitter. It's so difficult to refrain from the fame aspect of it, to get more followers, to get more likes. And honestly, the only reason I'm doing Twitter is because, you know, you have Zamzam Academy, we have books and so on. You have to do some promotion of your books and so on. And there's two ways to do it. One is you pay for mailing lists, pay for emails and all that kind of stuff, whether they get to people or not. That's one way of doing it. The other way, which is the modern way, is get a large following of people. Then whatever you tell, I've written this piece, I've written this article, people will know about it. Do you understand? We're really living in a weird world, a really weird world. For people who don't care, it's okay. You just follow the trends. But for people who care, then you have to really think, why are you doing this? What's the justification? Is your justification really justified? It's a really difficult thing to do. So the first words on your tongue is the remembrance of Allah Most High. Say at this time, Alhamdulillahi alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi an-nushur. Asbahna wa asbaha al-mulku lillah. Wal-azamatu wa-sultanu lillah. Wal-izzatu wal-qudratu lillah. So powerful. Praise be to Allah who has brought us back to life after causing us to die, and to whom shall be the resurrection. We've entered the morning, as has the entire dominion, the entire kingdom belonging to Allah. Grandeur and might belongs to Allah. Magnificence and power belong to Allah. We have entered the morning upon the natural faith of submission, upon the word of sincerity in the religion of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the nation of our father Ibrahim, a pure monotheist and one who submitted to God, who was not of the idolaters. Just doesn't do justice. The English translation doesn't do justice. Asbahna ala fitrat al-Islam wa ala kalimat al-ikhlas wa ala deen nabiyyina Muhammadin sallallahu alaihi wasallam وعلى ملة أبينا إبراهيم حنيفا مسلما وما كان من المشركين اللهم بك أصبحنا وبك أمسينا وبك نحيا وبك نموت وإليك النشور اللهم إنا نسألك أن تبعثنا في هذا اليوم إلى كل خير. Oh Allah, we ask you to send us to every good thing on this day. And ونعوذ بك أن نشتريح فيه سوءا أو نجره إلى مسلم أو يجره أحد إلينا. And we ask you for the good of this day and the best of what it holds, and we seek refuge with you from the evils of this day and the evil that it holds. نسألك خير هذا اليوم وخير ما فيها ونعوذ بك من شرها وشر ما فيها. And then he says, thereafter when you dress, make your intention obedience to Allah's command by covering yourself appropriately. So everything down to the intention you should have even when putting on your clothing. Now let's move forward to page 48. He takes you through all the procedure. You're in the masjid now. So on page 48, what you've done is you've just performed Fajr prayer. You've done your some tasbihat, etc. Now what he's going to tell you is second paragraph, page 48. Your time from after the morning prayer until sunrise, when you're waiting for Ishraq prayer, what do you do between that time? Should be divided between four types of spiritual work. Try to get four things into that time. This is very practical. Number one, dua, supplication. Whether that's your own dua or get a book of duas like al-Hizb al-A'zam or something like that with meaning so you know what you're asking. So duas. Number two, remembrance and glorifications which you can repeat on prayer beads. Tasbih. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah. So tasbihat, dua. And number three, recitation of the Quran and some Quran reading. And number four, reflection. So if anybody does anything, we do tasbihat first, I would say. Then we do some dua. This too we do. Recitation of the Quran, some people do, some people do later, some people don't do. But reflection, hardly anybody does, unfortunately. And that's very powerful. Muraqabah. There's many types of muraqabah that you could do. You know, whether that's muraqabah of death, of how it's going to be, muraqabah of the bounties of Allah upon us and how ungrateful we are, the bounties of all the problems we've, the muraqabah of how many sins we've committed, how our life is going, are we any better than we were last year, and so on and so forth. It's just introspection. Even if you can do that for 5 minutes, it will be extremely beneficial. The biggest malady today is that people don't think about themselves, except in terms of the dunya. They check how much money they have, they check whether they're going to buy that new car or whatever, but they never check as to what our situation is with Allah. The only time we do that is when we suffer a loss, an accident, a setback, a demotion, or anything, or some other kind of loss, then we start thinking, how's our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So that muraqabah is extremely important. And then he says, which you can repeat on prayer beads. So he's promoting the tasbih. And you know, the tasbih is such a beautiful thing. Because what happens is we're so distracted as individuals. And we live in a very distracted world. That if you don't have a tasbih, then you start, subhanallah, 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 subhanallah. And then your mind starts wandering, and then after that, you come back to and you don't know where you were. But if you've got a tasbih that you're holding, and you know your half, you know your fingers are going to move, and unless you become so professional that your fingers will even move, then some people are speaking to you and they're moving the tasbih beads. Right. In fact, in some Arab cultures, like in Syria and in some other places, it's a tradition to carry a tasbih with you. They just carry it with you. So it's, you know, like having a pocket clock, watch, or, you know, the other accessories that you have. A tasbih is an accessory. But I'm assuming that if you've got a tasbih in your hand, you are going to read something. What I did notice in Syria when I was studying there is that the amount of du'as they give to each other is amazing. They spread du'as, like you called, I remember once he called up the phone directory. Allah yu'tika al-afiyah, so-and-so, Allah yu'tika al-afiyah. I go to buy milk, and the guy, he gives it to me, and he says, Mu'awwadeen, may you be rewarded. It's just dua on everything. We don't give dua. Our Indian Pakistani culture, dua is a formal thing for us. You have to sit down, raise your hands, and do it. Even when people tell you, make dua for me, you'll say, okay, I'll do it for you. And then you forget. That's what I noticed, that I forget. Then you have to say, oh Allah, give, you know, reward all of those people who've asked me, because you can't even remember. I remember it was a Mauritanian scholar. I said, please make dua, you know, نَلْتَمِسُ مِنْكُمُ الدُّعَاءُ وَدُعُوا لَنَا. Immediately he starts dua. Immediately he starts dua. And then out of habit, he's given us the dua for about, you know, 5, 7, 8 duas for about, you know, like 50 seconds or something. And then you meet him again and then you say, out of habit, please make dua for us. And then he'll start again. So they give straight away dua. And that's, inculcate that in your life. Somebody asks you for dua, immediately say something. Now, if you're not used to it, you'll find it difficult to say a dua because it's kind of weird embarrassment you have, because dua seems to be such a private thing. So sit down one day and just figure out, okay, you know, somebody says dua and they've just told you about a loss. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make things easy for you. May Allah grant you patience. Right? So just think of certain duas that you can use. If it's about some happiness or something, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you greater happiness in your life. May Allah give you tawfiq. So have these du'as that you know that you can give immediately. You fulfilled your responsibility. But that's a very good adab. And that's why Imam Shafi'i says that you should travel. Because safar, travel, has 5 benefits. And one of them is that you will learn things that you don't know in your own culture. Not every culture is perfect. Every culture is good and bad. When you travel, then you pick the good, unless you're looking for the bad of other cultures. You know, there's people who go and they find the evil in all cultures, you know, where the dealers are and where this are. And sometimes people tell you and you think, how did you know? He says, no, you know. Yeah. Right? So, dua is very important. So going back to this, after Fajr, spend time doing this. And, you know, for Hanafis, if they're praying Fajr in the masjid, then they're going to have probably about half an hour, 25 minutes, based on the tradition of this country. People, their jamaat is about half an hour, maximum 40 minutes. With the Shafis, it's much longer because they pray earlier. But regardless, even if you spend 5 minutes in each of this, 5 minutes on dua, 5 minutes on reading the Quran, maybe do a bit more reading of the Quran, but 5 minutes on reflection, and 5 minutes on tasbih. So that's the benefit of the tasbih, that it reminds you. Even when you're traveling, you're on a coach, you're in a car, you're just sitting there. If you use a tasbih, the benefit is that, and I believe that these are actually better than those digital ones. Digital ones are more, you know, you're not walking on the street with this big tasbih in hand looking like a pious guy. But it's, if you want to remind yourself, then this is even better, because with that one, it becomes so second nature to you that you forget you've even got it on your finger. It becomes an accessory, like a ring. So there's benefits and harms. Everybody can do what they feel is better. But the benefit of the tasbih is that you'll remember and you can carry on where you left off. So that's what he says. And the only way this will become bid'ah is if you think it's sunnah to use this particular tasbih. Because we have a basis in Juwayriya radiallahu anha's hadith, where she sat and she was counting on beads. So there are different beads, and they're probably not strung like this, but there's a basis for it. So that's why even many have accepted that fact, and it's just the kind of extreme ones that bid'ah on everything, you know. Okay. So spend on these 4 things, and I think inshallah from tomorrow we can start doing this. 20 minutes, that's all we're asking for. And what I would suggest for women who, and even for men really, is that if you just get up 15 minutes before Fajr time, you see, men have to worry about they have to worry about Jama'at in the masjid. And Jama'at in the masjid in the Hanafi places is well after Tahajjud time. So you have to wake up for Tahajjud at least 20, 30 minutes there. Then you have to wait all the way to Fajr. Then after Fajr, you have to wait until sunrise. Otherwise, our brothers will say, you know, you're not doing Ishraq, right? So then, that's a lot. For women, it's easy. They just have to get up at home, right? So get up 20 minutes before Fajr. 5 minutes wudu, etc. 10, 15 minutes Tahajjud and Dua. As soon as Fajr time comes in, do your Fajr, go to sleep. You're going to get up for Fajr anyway. Why don't you just get up 15, 20 minutes before? So you can do Fajr and Tahajjud together. And it's actually, for women, it's better to do it in that dark, in that initial period anyway. So start doing Tahajjud and Fajr together. That's really beneficial. I think, you know, in our especially concentrated communities like this, we should have some masajid where the Fajr is early. Because there's also this survey of Medina, Munawwara, that there were some masajid where the Fajr was early, and that's why there's that ikhtilaf of when, you know, because the Hanafis, they say you should pray later when it becomes brighter, isfar, but we should have at least one or two places where the Fajr is early, so those who want to do tahajjud, they can actually go and do Fajr and then go to sleep. They get their jama'ah and they get their tahajjud. Because I'm assuming if, in this area, if all of the masajid are doing their Fajr late, then it's difficult, isn't it, for people? So it might be an idea that those who are imams or community committee members, that they could consider this, to have one of the masjids that are earlier, like in Batley as well and other places. It'll be something to think about. Because yes, it's mustahab to wait till late, but tahajjud is a stronger sunnah than the mustahab of isfar, I would think. Right? Tahajjud is way more valuable than delaying your fajr. I'm not diminishing the status of fajr being delayed, but tahajjud, if we can get that, and if people are being put off from praying Fajr because then they have to wait for Fajr Jama'at, and they think Jama'at is very important, which is, it is, it is. So that's why it's to do both. Wallahu A'lam. Reflect upon your mistakes and sins and the shortcomings and deficiencies in your worship of your master, and how you have exposed yourself to Allah's painful punishment with His great anger. This is the reflection. This is a type of introspection, muraqabah. Organize your regular duties of worship for the entire day by means of careful planning, in the hope of redeeming your past failings and shortcomings, and in the hope of guarding yourself by this means from exposure to the anger of Allah Almighty, Most Majestic, during the day. So think what you're going to do. Have a schedule set up at Fajr time of what you're going to do in your day. Make your intention, general intention, of having goodwill towards all Muslims, and resolve that your entire day will be occupied only with obedience to Allah Most High. If you start off like that, we're less likely to do the wrong things. Because when you start off with a good foundation intention, then even though we will have challenges, it'll be easier to deal with. Detail in your heart the acts of obedience of which you are capable. Then choose the best of them. Consider how to prepare the conditions to bring about such acts, so you can occupy yourself with them. Do not neglect to reflect upon the nearness of your end, upon the approach of death that cuts short all hopes, upon the removal of matters from the domain of your free will, and the possibility of reaching a state of sorrow and deep regret due to prolonged delusion. And then there are 10 du'as that he mentions afterwards. Now we move to page 56. So as he's going through the day, he's providing advice. Actually, page 54, just before that. He speaks about the ways you can spend your day, the main focus of your day. So he speaks about worship, good works, earning a living and protecting your religion. As I said, he's very begrudgingly allowing people to go and earn their living. Right, because he's at that level of tawakkul, which obviously we're not. The fourth state is that lacking the strength for these things, you occupy yourself with your own needs, earning a living to take care of yourself and your family. But you do this in such a way that Muslims are safe from your tongue and your hand, and your religion is safe because you would not be committing sins. In this way, you will reach the levels of the people of the right, the Ashabul Yameen. Even if you cannot be of those who rise to the level of the forerunners. So even though you may not be from the sabiqoon, you'll still be from the ashabul yameen, which is the second category. And this, meaning the level of the people of the right, is the lowest of the levels of religion, for below it are the grazing grounds of devils. which you would enter as a result of working, may Allah protect us, in that which ruins your religion. So be careful what job you do. I give you an example of some of the pitfalls in this. Somebody asked the question that I work outside the city in this remote town where there's no Muslims. It's a village, for example, and I'm the only Muslim worker there, so I'm going out on consultation or something like that. Do I have to do Jumu'ah? So I ask him, okay, he said, and he even knows, he says, it's beyond 48 miles. So technically speaking, once you're beyond 48 miles, you're a musafir, you're a traveler, and thus you don't have to do Jumu'ah prayer. You can do dhar. So then I asked him, I said, how long is this job for? He says, well, it's for, you know, two, three, four, foreseeable future. I'm going to be working there every Friday. So then the question that arises, okay, according to the fiqh, you can miss your Jumu'ah. But ethically speaking, how do you feel about a life without Jumu'ah for 2 years? How do you feel about that? As a Muslim, Jumu'ah is so important. You miss three Jumu'ahs, taking it lightly, as the hadith says, then a seal is placed on your heart. So our masail, we shouldn't just look at them theoretically and technically. Oh, the beard, according to the Shafi'is, is just this or that, only this size, or it's not wajib, it's only sunnah, mu'akkada, and you go into these gymnastics, you know, this juristic gymnastics. What does Allah want from you? How was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Once you start feeling like you want to be like him, then it doesn't matter whether it's fard, wajib, mustahab, or sunnah. Because that's my goal. Okay, today I might not be able to have a beard or put a niqab or cover my hair even. We've got sisters who are very good. They want to be good, but they can't cover for whatever reason, social pressure, family pressure, husband pressure, whatever it may be, right? But never be satisfied with your status quo. Always want to get better. So tomorrow, I can't do it today, inshallah tomorrow. Now, there's guys who want beards, but their wives complain that it's prickly. You have that. My wife keeps complaining, they say. I don't know if that's a masculinity crisis or if that's a feminine crisis. I don't know. People come with all sorts of excuses. At the end of the day, their mind knows how to make excuses. The main thing is be objective. Have your goal as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's how you want to be like in his behavior, in everything. So I can't do it today, but inshallah tomorrow I'll do it. Then the tawfiq will come. Know that a servant is at one of three levels in terms of his religion. Imam Ghazali, as you notice, he likes typologies. He loves his typologies. He categorizes everything, which makes it easy for us to understand. He says there's three levels. The safe one, the one who profits, and the loser. The safe one is the one who suffices with doing the basic obligatory acts and does not commit sins. As that individual came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I'm only going to do this, la azidu alayha wa la anqus. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, aflaha wa abihi in sadaq. That he's a winner. If he's truthful in practicing this, then he's a winner. So that's one who suffices, and there's lots of layers to that discussion there, but one who suffices with doing the basic obligatory deeds and does not commit sins. Number two, the one who profits is the one who voluntarily performs good deeds and voluntary acts above the obligatory. And number three, the loser is the one who falls short even in his performance of the obligatory acts. Therefore, if you cannot be one of the profiting ones, then at least put your effort in being among the safe ones. At least break even. And beware of being among the losers. In terms of his relationship with his fellows, a servant is one of three levels, another typology. The highest, the middle, and the lowest. He's got three classes here, right? We shouldn't have two classes, we should always have three classes. Because there's always going to be a third class. What's the ayah in the Quran? وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدْ فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ. People who are inheritors of our book, among them this just shows, the Quran is telling us, Allah is telling us, the three categories of people that will always be around. فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ Those that will be oppressors to themselves, meaning those who are doing wrong. And then? وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدْ Those who are on the path of moderation. And then? And those who are going ahead with extra goodness. So you've got the three classes that are mentioned in the Quran. That's why I mentioned to somebody, I was talking about to somebody who's from a particular Sufi group. And I said, but among your group, you've got a lot of people who are degenerated like this and that. And this was the response he gave to me. He says, that's quite natural. It's quite a normal thing. You'll have that in every category of people. You'll have that in every vocation. You'll have the dhalimul li nafsi. You'll have those who are on moderation. And you'll have those who go beyond that and who do more. So the highest is that he acts with, in terms of his relationship with his fellows, how do you deal with people? This is a brief section. In the end, he has a more detailed section. But here he says that the highest level in this is that he acts with them as the reverent and noble angels do. This is by striving to help with their needs out of kindness to them and by bringing happiness to their hearts. So you're a happy Muslim making other people happy. You're like the angels with a high level of compassion. You've got a lot of shafaqah within you and you feel softness towards people, altruistically helping people for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can altruism exist with Islam? That's a thing I've been thinking about. It depends on how you define altruism. Because altruism is like selfless act of kindness for others with no motive whatsoever to gain anything. But our motive is always for the sake of Allah. So that's our altruism, I would say. Number two, the middle, that he be with them as an animal or an inanimate object would be. That might sound very crude to people, but that's what the reality is. If you can't benefit them, then act like a dumb animal with them. What that means is, you may not bring them any good, you can't help them, but he doesn't do them any harm. A cow, a sheep, they just walk around, do their own stuff. And you do get a few aggressive cows, by the way. But in India, they're walking on the streets, and sometimes you just have to be a bit careful if they're taking a liking for you, right? So just be like an inanimate object. You're not benefiting them. He didn't make them an inanimate object. He gave them the level of animals, at least, right? In that, inherently, what he's saying is don't be like this. Be like the angels. You don't want to be like an animal. So look at it positively or negatively. It's just too good. It's just too good. Number three, the lowest, that he be with them as scorpions, serpents, or wild beasts would be. No one hopes for good from him and evil is feared of him. You're constantly ravaging people, arguing with them, disputing them. Even when you try to follow this, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا I remember there was this brother who had an argument with another brother and then it became Ramadan. So he comes out of the masjid and he says to him, Assalamu alaikum. Because the Quran says that, you know, when an ignorant person confronts you, and say salam to them. What he means is that deal with it peacefully, move along peacefully, like just kind of don't engage. This person took it literally to show the other person is ignorant. He said, Assalamu alaikum. I'm doing what the Quran is telling me to do. That's just personality problems. Therefore, if you cannot reach the horizons of the angels, then beware of falling below the level of animals and inanimate objects down to the level of scorpions and snakes. This is what I like most about Imam Ghazali. He really makes you think, where are you? Who are you? What status are you in? What's your actions? Where are they taking you? So he builds that typology first. And then after that, he makes you think, where are you? If you are content for yourself to come down from the highest of levels, okay, fine, you don't want to be on the highest levels, then do not accept for yourself to be hurled down to the lowest of the low, for hopefully you will be saved by doing just enough, neither achieving much nor losing all. Again, in Arabic, this sounds much better. فَإِنْ رَضِيتَ لِنَفْسِكَ النُّزُولَ مِنْ أَعْلَى عِلِّيِّينَ فَلَا تَرْضَ لَهَا بِالْهَوِيِّ إِلَىٰ أَسْفَلِ سَافِلِينَ فَلَعَلَّكَ أَن تَنْجُوَ كَفَافًا لَا لَكَ وَلَا عَلَيْكَ Have you seen the beauty of the... check the sentence. This is a facing translation. The last paragraph, فَإِنْ رَضِيْتَ لِنَفْسِكَ. It's from, if you are content with yourself, that takes about 4 lines of English and only 1.5 lines of Arabic. The Arabic script which Allah chose the Quran for is so beautiful that you can say so much in a small amount. And one of the things that you can notice immediately is that the vowels in English are letters. They take a whole text block, right? Whole word, place, A, E, I, O, U. The smallest one is probably the I if you write it just like that. But if you've got the top and bottom bars on it, then that becomes big as well. But with Arabic, you got your fatha, kasra, and dhamma, and a sukoon. You know, little fatha, kasra, dhamma, and the letters, and you just add them on. So you can say the word in with just 3 letters, and you just put the vowels wherever you want. Just a beautiful language, down to its script, not just the way it sounds, not to its effect, and its rhythm, its cadence, its nazam and composition, down to the letters that it comes from, and its formulation. Therefore, by the light of your day, you should occupy yourself only with what benefits you in your afterlife and with gaining these provisions in this life, which you cannot dispense with to assist you towards your afterlife. So he's saying only earn enough to get you through the life. So he wants the perfect human being. We won't be able to survive with this. Then if you cannot manage to fulfill the rights of your religion while associating with people and you cannot remain safe, then solitude is better for you. You should adopt solitude for in it is safety. If you can't help arguing with people and whatever, then just stay in your house. If now somebody is going to stay in his house, you see, before you could shut fitna out of your house, but now it gets beamed right down to your hand. So how can you shut fitna out of your house? You close your doors, but then you have your phone, your smartphone, and it gets beamed right down to that. It's very difficult now. We live in a very strange time. May Allah protect us. So then he's saying that, okay, fine, you've agreed to be in solitude. You've chosen to be alone. If in your solitude, though, devilish insinuations draw you to that which is displeasing to Allah, and you cannot root them out with the duties of worship, then you should go to sleep. This is the part I was talking about. After trying all of that, go to sleep. That is the best state for you and for us, for everybody. When we are unable to gain any spoils of battle, we are at least content with safety in defeat. But, you know, just in case people start getting happy with that, how sorry is the state of one who can only save his religion by making his life non-functional? After all, sleep is the brother of death. It is to suspend progress in life and join company with inanimate things. Heed this and you will be divinely guided if Allah so wills. Allah help us, we waste so much time. Let's look at page 60 now. This is, I think, the height of this chapter, this particular third paragraph. Your time, you know, people are complaining about how to organize their time, no barakah in time. This is when he gets to the crux of it. He says, your time should not be without any structure, such that you occupy yourself arbitrarily with whatever comes along. You got no plan. This, that, or the other, you just do this, then you do that, then you do this. Rather, you must take account of yourself and order your worship during the day and the night, assigning to each period of time an activity that must not be neglected, nor replaced by another activity. By this ordering of time, the blessing in time will show itself. A person who leaves himself without a plan, as animals do, he has to slip things in like that, doesn't he? Right. Not knowing what he is to do at any given moment, will spend most of his time fruitlessly. You know how we do that? You check your WhatsApp, you've got about 5 or 6 groups you're on, which is quite less, you know, 5 groups you're on. And in each of these groups, you've got 50 people or something. That's the maximum. Is it 70 now? Right. So people don't stop talking. So you've just cleared all of your groups, you've read everything, and then suddenly you get another notification. Somebody just said something. You have to check it up. Jazakallah. Ameen. Then again, Ameen. Ameen. That's a moment of your time. It's a good thing. Ameen is a good thing. But to read those Ameens. And you've done that, then you go onto your Twitter. Then you have to check on your Twitter how many people retweeted you, how many people have responded to you, what's others saying. That's why I don't follow many people on Twitter, because I just can't handle it. There's people who follow 500 people. How do you do that? If 500 people are tweeting just one tweet, that's 500 tweets that you have to go through. How do you do that? That's in addition to the Facebook notifications. And I'm not even on there, so I don't even know how bad that is. But I know that is worse than Twitter. That much I know. So you're checking that, you're checking this, you're checking that. Then within all of that, it's not just checking it. They're going to tell you, watch this YouTube video. Check this article out. So you can ignore some of them, but how many are you going to ignore? And you're going to start going and looking at others, that YouTube video. When you get onto YouTube, YouTube doesn't let you finish, does it? After you finish yours, on what I've seen on my phone, and the computer is different, it's advertisements all around. On the phone, it can't. So it gives you your window. When you finish, it minimizes that and gives you all of these other options, like really fast. So then, that looks interesting. And it's so intelligent. Because the way it's been programmed, algorithms that have been placed in there, they know exactly what you want. If you really want to know what you watch on YouTube, then just go and look at what it suggests to you. And they'll tell you. You wonder, why is that? Well, it's probably because you've looked at it before or something like that. So how are we going to escape from that? This takes 1 to 2 hours. There are people, you tell them to do dhikr. Have you done your muraqabah? Have you done your tasbihat? I don't get time. Then you see them online responding to people, responding to just silly things, being part of the discussion. You can go on, if somebody was to tell you to do 20 minutes on dhikr, muraqabah, whatever dhikr you do, on your musalla, that is so difficult. Then once you get on your YouTube or whatever and go from one thing to the other, and wow, 50 minutes have passed, 1.5 hours have passed. You feel bad about it, but you'll still do it again. Because it goes so fast, so easily. That's the life we're living in. But it's such a khabees thing that, you know, you have to use it. You have to use it. I'm not of those that ban Facebook, ban this, ban that. There's a lot of good that's on all of these things. That it's just discipline. The only way you can get discipline is to connect yourself with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by doing dhikr, by doing some serious dhikr. Otherwise, there's no escape from it. Your time should not be without any structure. So then he says, by this ordering of time, the blessing in time will show itself. A person who leaves himself without a plan, as animals do, not knowing what he is to do at any given moment, will spend most of his time fruitlessly. Your time is your life. Your life is your capital. By it you make your trade. Your life is your money, your capital, which you're going to make your business with. And if your father or somebody or the bank loan, haram loan, gave you £10,000 to start a business, and then you start having party after party with that business, with that 10,000, what business are you going to do? You think, oh great, I've got 10,000, let me do this. So that's why he's saying, your time is your life, your life is your capital. رَأْسُ مَالِكَ. By it you make your trade, and by it you reach the eternal bounties in the proximity of Allah. Every single breath of yours is a priceless jewel because it is irreplaceable. Once it is gone, there is no return for it. So do not be like fools who rejoice each day as their wealth increases while their lives decrease. Why can't we be given most of our money in our early life so we can enjoy it? Then as we get older, then we have life, then we become more stingy, then we start thinking about others, and then you can't really enjoy it. What's the point? What good is there in wealth that increases while one's lifespan decreases? Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah, he said, money can only benefit you when it leaves you. Money can't benefit you if it doesn't leave you. You can have as much money as you want, but what benefit is going to give you until you start spending it? Whether in the good or the bad. Then you buy things with it to eat, to wear, to do, or you spend it investing for your hereafter. Otherwise it won't benefit you. Keeping it is not going to benefit you. You become a miser. You become stingy. And people find that despicable. Do not rejoice except in an increase of knowledge or an increase of good works. Truly, they are your two friends who will accompany you in your grave when your spouse, your wealth, your children, and your friends will remain behind. Then, when the sun turns red, make your effort to return to the masjid before the sunset and occupy yourself in glorifying Allah and seeking forgiveness. The special merit of this time is comparable to the special merit of the time before the sunrise. Allah Almighty, Most Majestic, says, glorify your Lord with praise. وَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ قَبْلَ طُلُوعِ الشَّمْسِ وَقَبْلَ غُرُوبِهَا. Before the rise of the sun and before its setting. So then he ends the daytime like that. Now let's have another, only 2-minute break this time, just to relax our minds.